and junior Bob Fleischer, pitting his abilities against some of the best players in the country and heading for stardom. Young talent like this is bound to guide Duke once again into the winner's circle. A year ago, they were the upset kings of the tournament. This year, though beaten by North Carolina, the Wake Forest Deacons are still a battling, scrapping five that never knows when to quit. It is a young team that looks off coach Carl Tasey for encouragement.
Caught in a situation like that, both of you are going to have to move one word to the other. Scream to the other. So we can have somebody on.
Come on, show you. Bad up, we're playing with a play.
Let's go, come on, come on.
Get in there, just do it now. Let's go.
Its major threat to slay any of the conference giants comes from a quick, active backcourt. In senior, Tony Byers, number 10, and freshman Skip Brown, number 15, the Deacons boast the highest scoring pair of guards in the ACC. And Brown's future is unlimited. He's got three more seasons to improve his 13 points per game average. Freshmen are revitalizing the Deacon drive, and Jerry Schellenberg, number 25, is another sizzling newcomer. With everyone but Byers returning, the aggressive, sharpshooting Wake Forest Deacons are ready to take their place with the power teams in this power conference.
No hold! No foul, Scotty!
As soon as the ball goes in the net, I want a timeout. It's going to cost us the technical.
In 4 years at Clemson, Coach Tate's Lock has bettered the Tigers' record each season. His creed is defense, determination, and discipline. He's putting together a spirited team that will be capable of winning the Super Tourney in a year or two. The springboard to Clemson's success is 7-foot-1-inch freshman Wayne Rollins, third in conference rebounding, double-figure scorer, and Tate's Lock says Rollins is going to be the best center in the ACC. Rollins' scoring partner is junior Van Gregg, a little lefty with a deadly shot. With Gregg popping outside, and big guys like Rollins and Wayne Croft developing their muscle inside, this smooth-moving Clemson team is about to reap the rewards of rebuilding. They are young. They make mistakes, and they are eliminated by Virginia. But they are improving, and with experience will come triumph at Clemson. The talent is there.
Get on the boards, then. Stay on the boards. Block out, get on the boards.
Only three can advance in this single elimination slugfest. On the first day, Maryland wins its 72nd victory since seniors Tom McMillan and Len Elmore joined the lineup as sophomores. It's been another phenomenal season for the Terrapins, and their sophomore flash, John Lucas, is the top scoring guard in the conference. With a 21-4 record, the Terps are a major source of concern to regular season champion, North Carolina State. Norm Sloan, with a bye on the first day, carefully studies the Maryland victory. The Cavaliers of Virginia join Maryland in the semifinals with a hard-earned win over Clemson. Virginia's strength is up front, where they have the highest scoring forward combination in the conference. From sophomore Wally Walker and junior Gus Gerard, the Cavs get rebounds, points, and leadership. These two can do it all, and they lead Virginia successfully through the first day of competition. Only UCLA has a better record over the past 8 years than Dean Smith's North Carolina Tar Heels. 21-4, North Carolina's success is another reason the ACC dominated the top 10 rankings. Elston drives the attack and averaged over 15 points a game. It was another great season for All-American Bobby Jones, number 34, rebound and scoring leader, and the key to Carolina's success. Dean Smith has come up with one of the ACC's top freshmen, Walter Davis. So North Carolina, as so often in the past, takes its place in the semifinal competition. Friday, March 8th, four teams remain. Only two can go on. The first semifinal game puts the Wolfpack of North Carolina State against the Cavaliers of the University of Virginia. Norm Sloan's Wolfpack are the nation's number one rated team. Led by All-American David Thompson, they are favored to win the tournament. With Thompson scoring the first 12 Wolfpack points, NC State is off and running. But the Wahoos are too good to lose to a one-man show. And spurred by head coach Bill Gibson, the young Cavaliers begin to realize it. Freshman Bill Langlo, number 21, sparks the underdogs. And with Gus Gerard and Wally Walker playing their hearts out, Virginia clings perspiringly close to North Carolina State throughout the first half. At the half, the Cavaliers trail the Wolfpack by just 2 points. But in the second half, Thompson puts together a string of seven. The NC State lead reaches 15 and the game is broken open. In the process, ACC fans get a good look at this awesome Wolfpack attack. 7'4" Tommy Burleson, the equal of any big man in America. Hustling Tim Stoddard, a much underrated forward. Junior Mo Rivers, who flows up and down the court setting up the big men. Five-six Monty Tao, the little man with the big shot. And the vital sixth spot manned by Phil Spence, who would start for most teams. The nation's number one team proves too much for the stubborn Cavaliers. David Thompson, with 37 points, leads NC State into the ACC Tournament Finals. After the game, Cavalier co-captain Bob McCaig awards the game ball to Mrs. Bill Gibson, for the game marks the last appearance of her husband as Cavalier head coach. ACC basketball. An experience that neither player nor coach will ever forget.
I wouldn't trade you for the world.
All that remains now is to determine NC State's rival in the championship game. Will it be Lefty Grizzell's Maryland Terrapins? Or Dean Smith's North Carolina Tar Heels? During the 73-74 season, North Carolina led the Atlantic Coast Conference in field goal percentage, and against Maryland, they start strong, hitting on their first shot. But it is a misleading beginning, for though they bang away at the boards, creating shot after shot, on this night, the hot-shooting Tar Heels hit some very cold spells. By contrast, Maryland is on fire, shooting 62% in the first half and bagging a 17-point lead. But Smith and the Tar Heels aren't about to give up.
Get inside of the board. That's a good foul last time. You got the board at the board. Now, a little bit at a time, Warner. The next one falls. Then you feel like it, all right? Everybody, turn your eyes to see that. Because anybody here doesn't think we're going to win. Oh, let me put the blue team in. I know we are. But we got to start now. Don't wait till half. Come on,
the Tar Heels' pressing defense forces some turnovers, and North Carolina claws to within striking distance. But Maryland, like NC State in the first semifinal game, has too many racehorses. Tom McMillan misses only 3 of 11 shots, scoring 20. Owen Brown drops 7 of 9. And Len Elmore chips in with 17 points. Though North Carolina hustles their hearts out, they simply cannot match the searing heat of the Terrapins, shooting an amazing 64% for the game. The final, 105-85. It is the seventh time this season the Terps reach 100 points. It is doubtful if any team could have beaten Maryland tonight. The championship game nears.
You know, it seems rather strange and if not unusual to sit here in the quiet of this atmosphere and recognize that just in a matter of a few hours, the most important athletic contest in the lives of some of our very fine young players will take place. Here we've had a year which is truly outstanding, with 3 of our teams never worse than the top 7 in the country. We have 5 of the top 10 basketball players the United States selected from our conference. And I think it's only fair that we recognize the outstanding contributions that these young men have made to our program. Fortunately for me, we started out 4 years ago with them as freshmen. Here we have Tom McMillan and Len Elmore, Tommy Burleson, Bobby Jones, and Darrell Elston, all leaving us this year who have just done an outstanding job for not only their institutions, but for the Atlantic Coast Conference. I know that tonight will truly prove the talent that these young men have displayed all year, and once again reflect all the credit on their institutions for the game that we're about to see.
Number 42 from LaGrange, Illinois, Owen Brown. And from Mansfield, Pennsylvania, number 54, Tom McMillan. From Brooklyn, New York, wearing number 10, Mo Rivers. Number 25 from Converse, Indiana, Monty Powell. Number 24.
It starts out like a Maryland runaway. The Terps continue their deadly shooting.
Go, 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 go,
and hit on 10 of their first 12 shots. And surprisingly, they dominate both boards. And Lefty Grizzell intends to keep the pressure on. The hot Terrapins threaten to blow the title game wide open, breezing to an amazing 25-12 lead. big question now is, can State's Norm Sloan halt the Maryland surge? His strategy? Go more to the big man, Tommy Burleson. In spite of rugged guarding by Len Elmore, the 7-4 Burleson begins to take charge, forcing Elmore into goaltending for even more points. While Elmore is having trouble guarding Burleson, imagine Owen Brown's problems going man-to-man with David Thompson. Attempting to stay with Thompson, Brown gets in foul trouble. It is a problem that will plague Maryland all night. When Tim Stoddard puts in the missed free throw, North Carolina State inches ahead for the first time. From there on, these two great teams seemingly hit from all corners of the Greensboro Coliseum. Maryland by 5 at the half, and the break provides a great time to take a deep breath and relax. At the outset of the second half, North Carolina State again looks like the nation's number one team. An attacking man-to-man defense. A fast break triggered by little Monty Tau. A twisting layup by Mo Rivers. The sky-high rebounding of Tom Burleson. The long, arching one-hander that is Monty Tau's trademark. And the fluid moves of one of the greatest to ever play the game, David Thompson. It's a combination that's got Lefty Grizzell upset. The Terps have squandered a lead and now trail by 5. Norm Sloan's team has shown the poise that carried it through 31 consecutive wins against conference opponents and an overall two-year record of 56-1. One of the finest teams in college basketball history. That's the hurdle facing Maryland. As so often in the past, Lefty's anger ignites the Terps and Maryland swings back into the driver's seat. They do it with a gambling defense and a lightning quick fast break. The points seem to flow quicker than the eye can follow, and Maryland reclaims the lead. It is again time for Tommy Burleson to become State's dominant force. He will score 24 of his game-high 38 points in the crucial second half. But when Burleson misses, Maryland is there to cash in. The lead changes nearly with every basket. However, at this point, late in a high-scoring game, three vital factors affect Maryland. One, after two tough games in 2 days, the Terps are tired, and State's Norm Sloan is ready to trigger the advantage.
Now's a good time now on the other end. Let's get a little movement, a little passing and movement, because they're getting awfully tired. Keep playing beautifully. Timmy's doing a great job on him. Whoever has the villain, really get up on him tight and make him go by. We're going to get some help. We're dropping off back in there and helping out. Okay?
Phil Spence hounds a tiring McMillan into a second half of just 6 points. The second problem creeping up on Maryland is fouls. Top rebounder Elmore has four. And Owen Brown leaves the battle with five.
The Maryland foul, number 42, Owen Brown, his fifth.
Then, a goaltending call on Maurice Howard allows North Carolina State a small margin. This battle narrows down to under 2 minutes. The Terps need a bucket to tie. McMillan to Elmore, and this game is tied. Less than a minute to play. State will look for one shot. But Tom McMillan steals the pass for the Terps. Now Maryland will have one last opportunity to beat State for the first time in 2 years. The Terrapins call a time with nine heartbeats left and set up, they hope, a winning play.
Look, you take it out of bounds, okay? You take it out of bounds. Here's a good play out of bounds. No, you get right in here, okay? Bust it out.
But the road is blocked. Lucas hurries a try, and regulation expires. Deadlock. Maryland and North Carolina State are extremely cautious in these five additional minutes. Both teams have played phenomenal basketball and are hungry for this biggest of all triumphs. Terrapin foul shots give Maryland a 100-99 advantage, but State's defense holds Maryland without a basket.
No foul, man, no foul.
It is here that little Monty Tau feeds the biggest assist of his career to unguarded Bill Spence, and State inches ahead 101-100. The Terrapins must retaliate, but an exhausted John Lucas is forced into a jump ball. Maryland reclaims possession. Less than a minute. State by one. And Lucas, double-teamed, throws a pass into the seats. State ball, with a chance to run out the clock. Tau is fouled. Two conversions will clinch the unbelievable victory for North Carolina State. It's all over. The most exciting basketball contest ever played in the ACC. The Wolfpack celebrate victory in a game of games. A battle, according to winning coach Norm Sloan, between the two best teams in college basketball. For State, it is a trip to the top of the mountain. The Wolfpack, after this fantastic victory, go on to beat UCLA, win the NCAA tournament, and finish the season number one in America. After 3 days of sensational basketball, a champion is decided, and five players are named to the coveted all-tournament team. Honored are Maryland's backcourt duo, Maurice Howard, and sophomore John Lucas. Joining teammate Tom McMillan, completing three brilliant years starring in this tourney. North Carolina State junior David Thompson, scoring leader with 66 points. And for the second consecutive year, the tourney's most valuable player, Tommy Burleson, 53 points, 24 rebounds, and the Wolfpack senior climaxes a fantastic career. The season, with more teams in the top seven than any other conference, the tournament, unmatched in history, and college basketball's number one team, it will be a year long remembered by ACC fans. And there are a multitude of talented young players returning, all with one desire, to end the two-year reign of the North Carolina State Wolfpack. It will not be easy, but that challenge, and the rugged rivalries it produces, made 1973-74 the greatest season ever, and make Atlantic Coast basketball the best in America.
The winners of the
special WBTV sports presentation is brought to you by your Harris Teeter Supermarkets, where you always get quality, variety, and hometown hospitality.
The greatest show on earth, Ringling Brothers Barnum & Bailey Circus, begins Tuesday, March the 26th. And Harris Teeter wants to help you with the purchase of tickets. In fact, if you'll go by Harris Teeter before you go to the circus, you can get a $2 discount on tickets. I know you'll enjoy the circus. Your whole family will enjoy the circus. And you'll particularly enjoy it opening night, Tuesday, March the 26th. So if you'd like to go, and yet you'd like to spend a little bit less on the tickets, let Harris Teeter help you. Remember that Harris Teeter has all the quality products that you could ever want for feeding your family properly and deliciously. They also bring you the best possible prices on their products, too. And now, a special to help you with the purchase of circus tickets. So don't forget, opening night, Tuesday, March the 26th, for Ringling Brothers Barnum & Bailey Circus. Save $2, a discount of $2 on tickets when you shop at the Harris Teeter store that's closest to you. So for grocery shopping and circus tickets shopping, shop Harris Teeter.
North Carolina State is one of America's great land-grant universities, involved in large-scale research programs and world activities. It also has a rich basketball heritage, born at Reynolds Coliseum, home of the Wolfpack. It was here that legendary Everett Case gave the South its first taste of big-time teams. Reynolds Trophy cases are well stocked with the spoils of that reign. Case molded his champions with imports from his native Indiana, sprinkled with selected stars from the East. They netted 378 victories in 18 seasons. Significantly, from one of Case's initial teams came a man to perpetuate that winning style. Fellow Hoosier Norman Sloan accepted the challenge. If he approached the task any different than his famous teacher, it was to build on a pair of home state products. His first recruiting coup was to sign rangy Tommy Burleson of Newlett. Then came quick and talented David Thompson of Shelby, destined to be one of the game's greatest. Joining these two was a 5.5-foot package of dynamite named Monty Tal and a band of other gifted players. What they were to do would write basketball history. It was a team effort all the way, but there was a special glow from the home state followers. Two of theirs, Tommy and David, were brilliant. And it's these two native sons of the Wolfpack we feature on the eve of the game of their lives. Reporter Bob Taylor captured the story of how this pair went from small towns to number one.
We didn't have any, we had no centers or anything like that, or gyms we could go to, but we had a lot of outdoor baskets that we played at, and then a lot of homemade gyms, which we converted barns into when we play in the wintertime. And so it would just be a bunch of guys playing.
And home for Tommy Burleson is Newland, North Carolina, a one traffic light town that proudly boasts to be the shrubbery capital of the South. But since Tommy hit the sports headlines, every block in town was as alive with basketballs as they were with shrubbery. And a couple of miles from the Avery County capital is the home of the Lorne Burlesons, a close-knit family in the mountain tradition.
What do you see as the most important thing that you gave to Tommy in his basketball career?
Well, I don't know, Bob, in growing up, Tommy, when he first started growing so tall, you know, he was thin at that time, and his legs weren't too good, so I ordered these shot packs from Sears Roebuck, and the 2.5 pound, you know, that you wear on your ankles and so forth, and he wore those things religiously. He wore them to school, he wore them to church, he would caddy on the golf course and carry double, and here he'd come with his shot packs on, and I think it did help his legs a lot. Tommy was always big. When he was about 10 years old, he got most of his height from 10 to 15. Those 5 years, four of those years, he grew 4 inches per year, and 1 year, 5 inches. I believe the 5 inches came when from 13 to 14.
Mr. Burleson, I guess this is a pretty special basket around the Burleson household.
Well, this one here, Bob, I've had it a pretty good while, but we used to have our baskets in the barn. It's torn down now. It was too old and got dangerous. So I put this one up. It's been here for quite some time.
Did you ever get out and work out with Tommy or practice with him? Or can you take him one-on-one?
I can't take him. The whole family worked. We all played together, my wife too. We'd get out and play every Sunday afternoon, Saturday.
Kid sister Linda now keeps up that outside tradition. If Tommy kept his weekends open for basketball, he was more generous with his time at another home function, the family dinner table.
He has a tremendous appetite. It was just next to impossible to feed him.
Tommy's a very adventurous person. He's a very daredevil-like. He doesn't care to, you know, try anything once, you know. And we just had a blast. We just had fun.
Did you fight like normal brothers and sisters?
Oh, yes. We had disagreements, especially with him being a boy and a girl being, a, you know, 2 years older than him. I felt like I should be the boss, but since he felt like he should be the man of the house, though.
Until he was in high school, basketball was not his interest. 4-H on the farm, and he, well, we had some cattle, and he always had a show calf that he cared for himself. And then finally, in his last year in high school, had the grand champion for Western North Carolina.
I understand he's prouder of that than he is of his basketball accomplishments.
In all honesty, that's his prize trophy.
So I don't see how anybody could possibly dislike any of those players. And I don't see how anybody could possibly dislike Tommy, because he's just such a friendly person and such a sincere person. And, I mean, we've just been raised that way. Our parents were just the most kindest people you'd ever know. And I used to think that women was all that's important to them until what happened last Saturday and then what happened today, but I just knew it wasn't. That those players are the most important part of us.
Mrs. Burleson, what about David Thompson? What kind of an influence has David Thompson had on Tommy Burleson's life?
Well, Bob, we've thought about it a lot. And I believe that he's the most outstanding young man we've ever known. And in all honesty, I believe he's influenced Tommy's life more than any individual. Being able to play with a ball player of that caliber is just, to us, unbelievable. For Tommy to be a part of it and for David to support him the way he does, it's just a miracle.
I've always read about him and heard about him, you know, through other people. And then when I got to meet him, it was just, I thought people were, you know, sort of kidding me that David was as good as he was and as great a person as he was. But after I met David and got to know him, he's even those people who told me about him were definitely wrong, because he's a much greater person than that ever was. He's, to me, David is just, his attitude and, like I say, companionship and everything, he's just, I wouldn't trade him for the world. He's the greatest person in the world.
Both of you fellows are from small towns. How do you learn to play basketball coming from small towns where there's not maybe as much competition as there is in a larger city?
The thing about me that I always was with a group of guys who was older than me, and I always played ball with guys who were like 3 or 4 years older than I am. And being that way, I was usually about the same height they were. And I think that's how, you know, helped my ball.
It helped his play so much that Tommy put brand new Avery County High on the basketball map. Coach Bruce Daniels even came out of retirement to run the team.
Well, I think anywhere in the state that you would go now and say that I'm from Newland, the first thing they'd think of, well, that's where Tom Burleson's from, isn't it? Prior to Tom becoming the outstanding basketball player that he was, Newland, you just wouldn't know where Newland was. But I'm sure that most people in the state of North Carolina knows that Newland is the home of Tom Burleson. I knew from the eighth grade, from his freshman year, that Tom would develop into an All-American. I even predicted that he would be All-American, and that when the time come for him to go into pro ball, that he would sign a lucrative contract, which I think is forthcoming.
Was that your main goal?
No.
Coaching?
No, it wasn't. My main goal toward Tom was to create in him an attitude, a good attitude toward life, because the way a person plays on the court is going to determine how he'll play the game of life, and I wanted Tom to develop that type of attitude, and he hasn't disappointed me at all.
How has that been reflected in his play, say, at North Carolina State, which is a very close team, both on and off the basketball court?
You can observe that with the inspiration and the love that each one of those members have toward each other. You can see it at the beginning of the game, how they just cherish each other. And had you watched the Eastern Regional Finals last Saturday, you would have seen the expression and love for David after he came back into the Coliseum after they had thought that he had probably been seriously injured. And they have a deep love, and I think Tom really has that toward each one of them.
Coach Sloan was one of the main factors, and then the school itself. And I always liked North Carolina State, and they had a growing basketball. The program out there was growing, and I saw a chance for me to get into it, and be able to play a lot, as center, because I would be stepping into a good position. And it was just like I said, Coach Sloan was a great coach, and the school and the people connected with the school were really, really great. One of the greatest teams, I think, was the greatest team I've ever played on, and it's most definitely probably be one of the greatest teams to go down in history because of the great individual talents such as, David Thompson, Monty Towle, Tim Stoddard, Phil Spence, Steve News. It's just Morris Rivers. Individual talent like this, it makes a team so great.
Among those who knew the game, there's never been any real doubt that Tommy Burleson would be a great basketball player, and it came from more than just his awesome height. He knew how to use that 7-foot-4-inch frame to strangle the opposition. Tommy was a member of the 1972 United States Olympic team. It meant valuable experience. That season, he wound up teaming with newcomers Thompson and Towle for a perfect season at state. And when the final victory was gained, Tommy was voted the coveted Everett Case Award as the ACC Tournament's best. The next year saw Tommy join David on the U.S. World University team, and those two dazzled the Russians in Moscow, walking off with another championship. Tommy is at his best in the big games, and his premier performance came against Maryland in a memorable showdown for the 1974 ACC title. Challenged by the Terrapins' great Lynn Elmore, Tommy rose to the occasion. As the 103-100 overtime victory went into the record books, it carried along the decisive 38-point performance of the tall young man from Newland. And when the ballots were counted, Tommy again won a second consecutive Case Award as the tournament's most valuable player. But despite all his accomplishments on the hardwood, and there were many of them, including All-America honors, Tommy's praise is for his neighboring teammate.
He's got the greatest ability I think God ever gave anyone player in the world. And if David wanted to, he could be the cockiest player, like I say, cockiest player in the world, because he could get out there and do it and then tell people to go jump in the lake. But David goes out there, he does it, he comes back off court, and he's just David. He's just, you know, he doesn't brag about what he does. He's just an outstanding individual. And to me, that among other, you know, other things, David just makes him, you know, one of the outstanding people that I ever know.
Hurry, hurry, hurry. The circus is coming to town, and you can join Harris Teeter opening night Tuesday, March 26th, and save $2 on all tickets. Moms, dads, grandmas, grandpas, what a great way to spend an evening with the young ones. Take them to see the greatest show on earth. Pick up your discount certificates at all Harris Teeter stores. Each $3 purchase entitles you to a $2 discount on any price ticket. See you at Harris Teeter night at the circus.
It takes good food to keep an active body healthy. That's what Harris Teeter is all about. Quality foods, the finest and largest selection of fresh fruits and vegetables, only USDA choice meats, trimmed by the ruler, and over 7,000 top quality items to choose from. Harris Teeter is more than a quality supermarket. It's knowing you're getting the best.
I forgot the cookies.
This week at Harris Teeter, U.S. Choice Quality Trim Beef Chuck Roast. Center cut, 69 cents a pound. This week at Harris Teeter, U.S. number one round white potatoes. 10-pound bag, $1.29.
Like Tommy Burleson, David Thompson also came from a small Western North Carolina high school.
Well, there were a lot of guys that would come out to recreation centers and backdoor baskets and play. You know, we played just about every day. That was about the only occurrence around that area. There weren't that much baseball or football during the time. And we would call up all our friends around the neighborhood and get together to play ball all day.
And an all-day game might well be in the front yard of Mr. and Mrs. Valley Thompson of Shelby. With 10 older brothers and sisters around, there was never a lack of competition for David. The old basket has been moved down now for the younger neighbors, but there are proud memories.
Ms. Thompson, what was David like when he was growing up? Yeah. Just a little bit.
Well, he always was a good boy. He liked to play basketball when he always had love to play. When he was little, he always had love to play basketball. He always liked to go to church, and he always sung on the junior chorus in church. I tell you, David it's just something about him, you know. I can't explain what makes, you know, the people like him, you know. David is normal. That's one reason, you know, the people's like him, so.
You were in Raleigh last weekend when the accident occurred. What was your feeling about the response from other people about David's well-being?
Everybody I know of, all over in Shelby High, all around Crest, they was pulling for him, you know. And it was some man's ball was on the jewel box, I can't think his name. That boy said he cried for a solid hour. And they all was praying for him, you know. This lady what worked in the library at Shelby, she said they had a solemn prayer in church for him.
Glistening in the Thompson living room are the trophies and plaques and awards won by their famous youngest child. It's a point of great pride in the Valley Thompson home. Out of the fiber industries plant where Mr. Thompson works, he used a break with Bob Taylor to recall his younger days with David.
Did you ever go out in the backyard and play ball with David?
Well, I went out there when he was shooting by himself sometimes. I'd get the ball and throw it up, and when I'd throw it up, shoot, I'd miss, something like that. He said, Daddy, that ain't right. So let me show you how to throw it up. And he'd give it kind of something like that. And so I'd try it like that, maybe hit one out of five or something like that.
Where did he learn to play basketball so well?
Well, he mostly learned, and he had him a goal up in the backyard down the field. And so he'd go down there every day and shoot by himself most of the time. And a lot of time his friends come down, he'd shoot with them. And a lot of time they would tell, he'd tell me, he's going to be a star someday. There's no change in my life, only I have, you know, a great feeling, you know, because David have made many friends, and we have met many friends, and seem like everybody loves him, and they respect us.
That seems to be an attitude that David really tries to get across, how much he loves other people.
That's right.
Has that always been true, David?
Yes, that's been true. He always, he had a boy that he usually stayed around with, and he didn't have a father, and he always he wanted to do something for him, and I always thought that was a good attitude.
When you say David Thompson is from Shelby, it's best to quickly add, and Crest High School. It was here that David first attracted national attention as an exceptional performer under Coach Ed Peter. Only one defeat his final season and a retired jersey number.
David is just a tremendous individual. I've known him since he was in the ninth grade, and I never run across a young man that just influenced people as much as he influences people in a shy but very aggressive type personality, yet he doesn't really, he's not really that outspoken. David, the first year or so he was here, his freshman, sophomore year, we were just struggling to have a good basketball team, but his junior year and senior year, he became the leader in an unassuming way, but yet he was a leader, and these young men that were played with him just picked up his key and followed suit.
And David's first year at the school was also the first year the school was open. What effect do you think those 4 years that David had here have had on this school and its operation?
Well, first, it's definitely made Crest High School be known over the country. But other than that, I think the fact that David was such a tremendous athlete and still is, Crest High School basketball has been great basketball in our mind, because the young men here want to pattern themselves after David and be good basketball players. And I think it's his impact on the integration here in our school and the integration in the county has had a big effect, because when we moved into the school, this was the first year of complete integration, and we haven't had any problems to speak of. I think he's had an influence on this.
Do you feel like these ball players have taught the state and maybe even the nation a lesson in something a little bit deeper than maybe basketball?
Well, if the state and the nation hadn't taken a lesson from them, it's not David and Tommy and Monty's fault. It's the people.
I knew State had the big dominating center, and I watched their freshman team play a lot. They had a lot of real good ball players, like Steve Noose, Steve Smurrell, and Steve Graham, some other good ball players. And I felt that I could fit in with this group. I talked with the guys, and they seemed to have a close companionship among themselves, and they seemed to love each other, same as my high school team. And I felt that it wouldn't be that much of an adjustment for me to just come right in.
Why is that important to you, the team aspect, the love aspect of the team?
Well, I think in order for a team to be successful to continue winning, they've got to be for each other and respect each other's ability and to love each other on the floor and off the floor.
Spectacular is too dull a word to describe David Thompson. He's reached every height in college basketball. In both his varsity seasons, the soft-spoken but dynamic superstar led the rugged Atlantic Coast Conference in scoring. Both seasons, he was accorded All-America honors. His teammates look on him in complete awe at his incredible play. Through it all, Thompson remains a 100% team man, never reaching for the limelight, yet standing above his competition in dazzling fashion. But as he is honored and saluted as a performer, David is even more loved and adored as a person. That was never more evident than when David suffered a frightening fall on his head against Pittsburgh in the NCAA Eastern Regionals at Raleigh. Listen now to David Thompson as he saw that near tragic happen.
Well, I don't remember it too clearly. I remember on the opposite end of the court, I went up for a jump shot, and I missed short, and they got the rebound and started down court. I kind of trailed the play, and I saw the guy break for the basket. And I took off from about somewhere in the vicinity of the foul line in an attempt to block the shot. And while I was up in the air, I hit one of my teammates. I think it was Phil Spence. My foot caught on his back, and that's all I remember.
David was back on hand before the end to watch Tommy, Monty, and the rest of the pack demolish the Panthers. Views on the UCLA game in a moment.
I've been so delighted to see beef prices come down, haven't you? Well, this weekend at Harris Teeter in the meat department, beef prices are going to come down even more because they're having a beef sale. And remember, all of the meat at Harris Teeter is quality trimmed, so you're going to be getting the most for your money when you buy these special prices on products. For example, for 89 cents a pound, you can get this shoulder roast, round bone, 89 cents a pound. Also, in Harris Teeter stores, you'll be able to buy U.S. Choice Chuck Roast. The center cut is only 69 cents a pound. Now, it's been a long time since you saw a price like this. And remember that in buying all of this meat, look for that word quality trimmed on the label. That means that they've trimmed away just as much of the excess bone and fat as possible. So you're getting just as much good edible meat as possible for your money. So if you want really good beef this weekend and you want it at a special saving, visit your local Harris Teeter store and take advantage of the beef sale.
Going into the ballgame tomorrow against UCLA after what many people considered a disappointing loss the first time you played them, how do you see the ballgame tomorrow?
I think we're a much improved team over the team we were when we played them the first time. We're getting great efforts from all players, a lot of new players like Marshall and Phil Spencer, and a lot to the team. And Tommy's playing the best ball of his career, and Monty's always a steady player. We're playing better defense, we're running a lot better, and we're just better overall. I think we'll be ready for this game.
I see the ball game. Well, the game tomorrow should be, people before, I think they've blown up the UCLA game too much because they said it was a rematch of the century and everything. We're going into, right now, as Coach Sloan says, we're going into the NCAA semifinals. And this is what we've been working for all year. And the UCLA game is our next game, so that is our most important game to us right now. To be able to get in the finals, we have to beat them. As everybody knows, they have a great team, and so do we. It's just that I don't think there's any rematch factor in it at all. I think it's an advantage to play a team once before you go into them and play them again because you get sort of used to, you get to know their personnel more and the type of ball they play.
So it has been two glorious years together for these two native sons who have shared the spotlight that has a special glow on superstars. Many athletes modestly credit others when lauded for their individual achievements. But there is a genuine sincerity about these two when they speak of Tao, of Stoddard, of Spence, of Rivers, and all the rest whose unity has so often led to victory. If a national championship is to come to Raleigh, it will belong to the team. But these two homegrown heroes will be remembered best among those who made it possible. Whether the next few days bring victory or defeat, they represent an era in North Carolina sports that already reads like a legend. In the years ahead, when their admirers reminisce about unforgettable people, they only need speak the names Tommy and David. That will be enough.
This special WBTV sports presentation has been brought to you by your Harris Teeter supermarkets, where you always get quality, variety, and hometown hospitality.
Wolfpack.
Each of the big college conferences square off against top-ranked independents from all over the country to see who really is number one. This year's scene, Greensboro Coliseum, Greensboro, North Carolina. The four final teams, 7 years running national champion UCLA, ranked number two, but clearly the team to beat. Big Eight winner, Kansas. Marquette, a strong independent with a 25-4 record, and number one ranked North Carolina State, coming off a spectacular 29-1 season. The first game of the semifinals pitted the Kansas Jayhawks against the Marquette Warriors in front of 15,829 fans at Greensboro Coliseum in Greensboro, North Carolina. The first half was a slow affair. Both teams unable to find the object of the game, the opponent's hoop. Both coaches try to settle their team's nerves. There were a few bright points. Subtle for Kansas. Lucas for Marquette. Greenlee for the Jayhawks. Lucas for the Warriors. Coach Ted Owens' Jayhawks took a 24-23 halftime lead, mostly because their 9-for-25 chill period was shorter than Marquette's 9-for-28. Jayhawk Roger Morningstar's two field goals, sandwiched around teammates Rick Settle's timely baskets, provided that one-point margin going into the locker room. Volatile coach Al McGuire of Marquette must have really given his players a piece of his mind, for the Warriors came back on the court for the second period, prepared to dictate the action of the game. Suttle single-handedly kept KU ahead for the first few minutes. But Lloyd Walton Steele off Tom Cavisto gave Marquette a go-ahead layup, 30-29. Marcus Washington looped in a key jumper. Bo Ellis picked up a free throw at the 15-minute mark. And Walton stole another pass 23 seconds later. The Jayhawks seemed to be losing their poise. Coach Owens tried to fire them up, but it was to no avail. Marcus Washington's 13 second-half points, combined with a 24-18 Marquette rebounding advantage and 9 Kansas turnovers, was the story of the second half. Coach McGuire concentrated on keeping fresh defensive men on Jayhawk guard Tom Cavisto.
A lot of pressure on Cavisto. He's starting to tire. He should start turning the ball over.
The Marquette tactic? To establish a smooth but confusing rhythm and force KU to play Marquette's game. And it worked. The Warriors slowly pulled ahead and won the game going away, 64-51. Washington, Lucas, and Tatum all ended the game for Marquette in double figures, while KU's Rick Settle was high man for the game with 19 points. But the real attraction at Greensboro was now about to get underway. The dramatic matchup between the top two teams in the country, North Carolina State and UCLA. The Bruins were a dynasty, a legend. No one had ever won 7 national basketball championships in a row before them, and UCLA was now going for its 8th. The Bruins had an amazing one-loss record going for them, stretching back over 5 years. They had intimidated many fine teams on this basis alone. But it was clear that the North Carolina State Wolfpack was not going to be intimidated. 7 foot 4 inch center Tom Burleson's attitude showed how fired up the team was. UCLA was led by All-American Bill Walton and was looking again to handle this North Carolina State team, which it had beaten so convincingly 3 months earlier, the Wolfpack's only loss. But it became clear right from the start that this game was going to be a different story. Among the dramatic matchups was Keith Wilkes and Dave Thompson, Bill Walton and Tom Burleson. And it was on these matchups that the game turned. The Pack matched UCLA point for point for the first 6 minutes of play. Walton's alert ball handling forced Burleson into foul trouble, upsetting the Wolfpack strategy. Playing inspired ball and collapsing state zone, UCLA pulled ahead, 19-14 at 8:39.
Help back in there. He gets some long jumpers. He's not that good a shooter.
Beat him up and down the floor now. Worse than Bart's, Phillip.
Yeah, let's go.
But David Thompson sparked the Pack to a sustained rally to go ahead of the fired-up Bruins, 35-33. State held for the last shot of the period. But the Bruins spoiled their bid and took it themselves on a last-second 20-footer to carry them into the locker room in a 35-all tie. Stoic UCLA coach John Wooten fired up his core, and they spurted to 14 points in the opening 4 minutes of the second half while holding state to only three. Note the two crucial turnovers. Carolina State coach Norm Sloan, who used only seven players with great discretion, called a crucial timeout. His mainstay, Tom Burleson, was still in foul trouble and would have to handle the explosive Walton with kid gloves.
Go ahead, square it up. You know, get to just break out deep, see what they do with you. Break deep, flare to one side, but go away from Phillip. You know, he passes the ball in, start down the other side, try to square it up.
On offense, the Wolfpack needed to penetrate the UCLan defense. To do that, they first had to hit from the outside, and hit they did. With 9:12 to play, State spurted to 8 straight points in only a minute and 22 seconds to narrow UCLA's margin from 57-46 to 57-54. After the two teams traded 4 baskets, the spunky Thompson, who collected 28 points to lead Wolfpack scoring in the game, put them ahead with a beautifully timed layup off an over-the-top pass from Stoddard at the 4:58 mark. And the crowd loved every minute of it. He was fouled on the play, missed the free throw, but Walton was called for invading the lane too soon, and Thompson didn't miss the second time. Then Bruin Dave Myers sank a basket at 4:35 to tie the game up at 63-all. By now, the crowd and all the sports world knew that this game was going to live up to their high expectations. Norm Sloan called his team together to consolidate their much-improved position.
Start trying to get it out. Now look, the guy that passes, don't just go lollipopping over the side. Pass the ball in shame to see where you should be. Maybe you should stay. And look, if they bring all three over, go all the way over.
His decision? Stall. And for 2 full minutes, stall they did. So did the Bruins. Both teams were looking for their best shot. The regulation time ended in a 65-65 tie. It was into overtime. And that meant a whole new ball game. North Carolina State picked up the tip-off, but Thompson's jumper bounced off the rim. After a great save by Wilkes, the Bruins lost the ball out of bounds. And then Burleson's turnaround gave the Pack first blood. UCLA worked the ball to Greg Lee, who hit from 22 feet out to knot the score at 67-all. Burleson was fouled by Myers. But he missed his chance to salt it away. Stoddard stole the ball back, and State was looking for the clincher, but Burleson's last-second effort fell short. The drama was heightened now beyond anyone's expectation. Double overtime in the NCAA semifinals between the nation's top two college teams. Both teams regrouped. If Coach Wooden's confidence in his 7-year national championship string was shaken, he didn't betray it. State again controlled the tip-off. After Thompson missed a long shot at 4:32, Walton was fouled by Burleson. The lanky All-American sank both ends of the 1-1 set, and now UCLA showed why they were perennial champions. After Burleson's shot was disallowed for goaltending, Walton hit a jumper at 3:50 for a 4-point Bruin advantage. Moe Rivers was off target on the return for the Carolinians' cause, and Burleson lost the ball out of bounds. UCLA worked the ball to Keith Wilkes, and the Wolfpack watched him finesse his way to a picture-perfect 3-point play and a 74-67 edge, which seemed to ensure victory with only 3:27 to play. But the Wolfpack poise, of which Norm Sloan was so proud, surfaced again in a time of real adversity. With the pressure mounting, little playmaker Monty Toe hit back-to-back free throws. UCLA's Tommy Curtis was fouled by the overeager Toe, and he proceeded to put through the first of two tries from the line to maintain a 6-point bowl. But Stoddard snared the rebound. Coming down court in a desperate situation, Dave Thompson tipped his own shot back in at the 3:01 mark to draw within 4 points. The Pack was back. The Bruins seemed to have lost control of the game, and they proceeded to lose the ball to Stoddard and Rivers with 1:57 to go. Burleson was playing with real fire and forced Walton into a foul. He hit the first point, but missed the second. Stoddard pulled it down. But the Wolfpack missed on three separate attempts. Ending with Monty Toe's miscue from the corner at 116. And this time, UCLA got the rebound. Myers was promptly fouled. And with a 1-1 coming up, he had a chance to put it on ice for the Bruins' eighth national championship in a row. He missed. Thompson cleared the boards and the Wolfpack drove down court. The feed went back to Thompson, who hit a driving bank shot to put State in the lead 76-75 as the crowd roared its approval. The Bruins set up Lee for a clear shot from 15 feet, but he missed it. Wilkes rebounded, but was called for pushing Thompson to gain board position. Thompson made both of these all-important shots, and the Pack had a 78-75 lead with only 34 seconds left. But it was Tom Burleson, appropriately, who capped the lid. With 27 seconds showing on the clock, he intercepted a lead of Walton Pack. State tried to stall, but Toe was fouled by Curtis. And his final two free throws put the game out of reach. And Greensboro Coliseum erupted in celebration. Final score in double overtime. North Carolina State 80, UCLA 77. Now, the finals. The high-flying Wolfpack against the stubborn Marquette Warriors. Marquette was now theoretically number two in the nation, so another 1-2 matchup was highly pleasing to the vocal home state crowd. And for most of the first half, the Warriors proved to be a match for the powerful Wolfpack. State bolted to an initial 10-2 lead in the first 4 minutes behind their usual starring combo of Thompson and Burleson. Marquette coach Al McGuire finally was able to restore order at 12 all. Five points in 33 seconds helped the Milwaukeeans keep pace. The lead changed hands seven times in this fiercely competitive struggle for national college basketball supremacy. With only 2 minutes and 48 seconds to go in the first half, Marquette held a 28-27 advantage. But then, lightning struck, attracted by Coach McGuire. Warrior Marcus Washington was called for charging. McGuire lived up to his reputation for temper by protesting vehemently. He was rewarded for his effort by being charged with a technical foul. David Thompson, who was to be voted the tournament's outstanding player, hit all three charity tosses. And then Burleson scored on the technical possession to turn a 5-point play to North Carolina State's advantage. But McGuire was not to be denied. Less than a minute later, Warrior freshman Bo Ellis was called for goaltending on a Phil Spence attempt. McGuire charged the court again. The referees promptly awarded Spence the basket, a free throw, and a new possession, as the rules for technical fouls dictate. The Wolfpack alertly cashed in on three of these five windfall points. The combination of these gifts from the Marquette bench put State comfortably into the lead, going into the locker room 39-30. And they really took charge at the opening of the second period. Sparked by Mo Rivers and Monty Toe, State jumped to a shockingly quick 45-30 advantage in the first 2 minutes out of the locker room. By the 15 minutes left mark, the lead had grown to a staggering 52-33. But Marquette was not going to fold. The Warriors rallied strongly behind Marcus Washington and Lloyd Walton to cut the margin to 46-55 with 10-13 remaining. But State still led 59-47 at the 8-minute mark on a jumper by Mo Rivers and a tip-in by the speedy Dave Thompson. Marquette was shackled by the tenacious Wolfpack defense, led by Rivers, Toe, and Stoddard, as well as the ever-present Thompson, which consistently kept Marquette out of effective scoring range. The Warriors won the rebounding derby 43-34 and pulled more turnovers 23-18, but it was in vain. As against UCLA two nights earlier, it was the Wolfpack's poise that really counted. Strongly pressured by Marquette's resurgence, as they watched a 19-point lead dwindle to 9, the Carolinians continued to play a smooth, even game of ball control. They forced the clock-conscious Milwaukeeans into several fouls, and in the highly charged atmosphere of the packed Coliseum, they kept their cool. By now, the North Carolina State lead was just too much to overcome, even by Al McGuire's never-say-die attitude. Marquette was playing its heart out, but with an increasingly obvious sense of desperation. The triumphant crowd sensed the victory and counted the clock down for the champions, a sweet 76-64 conquest and undisputed position as number one. North Carolina State Wolfpack had come a long way to get here. A spectacular 31-1 season climaxed at Greensboro. They avenged their only loss by defeating UCLA and ending the longest dynasty in college basketball. Wolfpack was on top.